In the first place, Prophet Muhammad, what he did, how they spread the Islam around the world, or his successor, what the ISIS doing currently now is less than them or more than them. Obviously less than Muhammad and the successor.
Britain has distanced themselves. They very much have.
No, they cannot.
They have. Islamic State has nothing to do with Islam.
No, they cannot say ISIS is not Muslim.
The way they put it is that it's not the interpretation, the correct interpretation, and this the point you're making is very true.
Yeah,
they are saying that it's what Muhammad did, and we are trying to recreate the Islam that Muhammad started in the area, but. Then there's lots of Islamist leaders who say that that interpretation is not the Islamic model today, but we just don't hear it much. It's important that it goes out to these people who want to join. There's still lots of people joining, and it's those countries where lots of people are joining from. That my point was that those countries need to step up and. Talk against ISIS within their countries. Not so much the European world. The number of people going from Europe is not much compared to how many join from.
What are you saying? I mean, maybe in some ways right, but I have not heard that they condemn the slaughter which is the ISIS done against the Yazidi, because in their opinion
they did.
Yeah, they said
the people of the book
they should count. Yeah, okay. But really, what they do is they are a real Muslim. Be honest. I came from the family Muslim. That's why I can't say that. But if you saying it or somebody else saying it, people taking it differently.
Should we let them answer the questions first, and then maybe if there's some others left, like because we have a time.
Can you summarize the questions and then?
try to. So basically, like one question was about the Islam, and the other was about Turkey's involvement. How left also in Turkey is kind of like as far as I remember saying what's going on in Rojava, peace negotiations, role of Öcalan, economy, and I think they remember it. Also, first I will kind of like let them answer, but I want to say a few things about Turkey because I'm from Turkey. Maybe I can contribute to some insights here.
Okay. Well, I'm going to quickly start because I have less to say than Adela, and then Elif, maybe you can talk about the demonstrations here and the problems we've had, or what we have been doing and the problems we've experienced. So I'm just going to kind of start from the questions that came at the end, exposing the relationship between Turkey. And thanks for making that point about arming YPG. And then, in fact, I had a point earlier that I missed was countries working more closely, or the coalition forces working more closely with PYD, that this is a demand that we need to make. And within that relationship, arming YPJ should be a demand within that. Because it's not just a single thing. They need much stronger political collaboration with PYG. So the exposing the relationship with Turkey is a really, really important point to make. We know the reason Turkey gets away with so much is because they have very strong business links with the UK and in terms of the US. Besides that, US has its air bases in the area. So the public actually knows this to a degree. It just needs to be an argument of whose side are we on in and historically, which I mean, the Kurds have been split in that region. They have been split because of the First World War coalition forces again betraying the Kurds and not giving land. We can't. It's not always easy to make a moral argument saying you've done it wrong, do it right this time, because it's mostly is based on the self-interest of the country, and we have to think pragmatically. Exposing why is it that Britain is not putting sufficient pressure on Turkey is important, but how do we do this? How do we get through to our MPs and say why don't you expose this? If you're really fighting against ISIS and you want to beat them, then you have to work with these Kurds and you need to put pressure on Turkey. That's really the argument that we need to make, because at the moment we don't see them really fighting against ISIS. That's not what it looks like, and this is what we need to question more. And there's another in terms of the Kurdish community. You can maybe quickly talk about what the Kurdish community is doing and what challenges we've had before you answer all the.
Before I go on to that, I just want to quickly mention and just in a way conclude like about the ISIS and the Islam and stuff. I think the main issue is it's not about ISIS does not represent Islam or whether it does or not. I think the main issue is that the governments, and especially these, you know, like the UK and America, they won't say or necessarily bring awareness that whether ISIS does or not represent Islam, because religion, you know, since the beginning of, civilization has been the most important and powerful tool for destruction, and that is what they've used it for. So they're not going to say ISIS does or does not represent Islam. I mean, I guess modern day, it does not represent modern day Islam, but that is how, this is not just Islam, so I don't want it to be seen as Islamophobic. Whether it's Islam, Christianity or whatever, it was spread by means of war. So right now, they are using, you know, historical understandings of spreading. We are spreading our religion by any means. You either convert or die or whatever. So the governments are not going to say it doesn't represent Islam, because then they lose their power. Because, for example, Turkey's not going to say that because they use religion as well. America's not going to say that because historically, and I guess to a very large extent, they use Christianity. So they will not undermine the power of religion by saying destructive behavior or controlling behavior does not represent a particular religion. Well, yes, exactly. So I just wanted to kind of have my own conclusion on that. And in terms of the obstacles that we've had with our demonstrations here, it's been hard because we've said, you know, we're protesting against ISIS, but the meaning of ISIS, people, we can relate to it in terms of, you know, our family, our comrades, and are in Kurdistan, so we understand and we hear about and read about directly the struggles. But a lot of people, like the general public, which are especially in the UK, they're not very politically aware. What does ISIS mean to them? ISIS does not affect them on their day-to-day life, and that's why 90% of our demonstrators will be Kurdish, and the 10% will be other ethnicities or you know, for other people, because it's hard for them to relate to it. And I think our demonstrations have been more successful than, you know, the past years, and there hasn't been enough coverage that we needed, but there has been a lot more than expected. So now there's an awareness about Rojava and Kovan, and I think the main thing we need to do now is, you know, because a lot of people are scared of politics, because it's very alien to them, because, you know, Erdogan mentioned as well, it should be the people who make the politics and the politicians just the administrations, but it's the complete opposite in, you know, such societies. That's why they're, you know, a lot of people at work or wherever you are, they'll say, oh no, I'm not political, I don't want to get involved in politics, but they don't understand that politics is life, that, you know, that is what defines your life. So people are alienated, and especially in these societies, it's very individualistic. So, you know, as long as I can get to work and get back home, watch my TV, it's fine. I don't need to get involved. And I think the main duty we have and we need to non-stop do is, how does what's happening in Rojava or politics in general, how does it affect your day-to-day life and why you need to speak up? And I think the obstacles we've had, if we use such strategies, we can, you know, come over them.
I think I will be a little bit careful when I try to use Islamic fascism. I mean, it takes completely all people who believes in Islam in one one thing. But under the mask of Islam, they are ISIS is a fascist, totalitarian organization. The problem is that we have what we have criticized a lot of organizations who have connections to Islam. Globally, they have not made enough statements also to protect themselves, the purity of Islam and this kind of thing. They have not condemned it very openly, very clearly, concrete. So this is the biggest criticism we had against them. There has been a conference on Islam, democratic conference on Islam in Diyarbakir, where they speak about the truth of the Islam and what has happened after Muhammad. So it's a little bit sensitive to say Islamic fascism, but about the situation in Turkey. I have also said before, a lot of the developments in Turkey is influencing the area in also in Rojava and also in other parts of the Middle East. And Öcalan has, of course, a very important key role, because Öcalan has trained 20,000 people in Rojava in his academic schools. So these people, after the training they had, education they had, they went out and made a lot of work in their struggles. Not only Kurds, but also Turks and other liberation movements have been educated in the area. So Öcalan is a very important person in the heart of the people in Rojava. But the thing is that we always say this after these last 3 months. We don't fight against ISIS, we are fighting against the Turkish government, because they wanted to use ISIS to eliminate Kurds. Many people would say the war has stopped in the north part of Kurdistan in Turkey, but it has actually not. It has only changed location. Turkey, they are still killing the Kurds, but they are just doing that by the hand of ISIS. And beyond the border. So there has been a very very intense discussions between the delegation from Turkish government and Öcalan. But at the same time, there has been also a lot of psychological warfare in the Turkish media. I mean, the way they have shown the image of Öcalan for 10 years ago is differently today, but they still want to show show as if he's a bad person. So the tone, the language has not changed a lot when they speak about PKK and Öcalan. But the last, we can say, one and a half year, the language in the media has been changed. So this was one of the demands when the negotiation, the dialogues started with Öcalan. But there's always a big discussion when they come to the Rojava issue, because Turkey is insisting to not accept the model which
which is implemented in Rojava, because they have this fear that the Kurds will do the same in the north part of Kurdistan, and they fear that Kurds will separate themselves and Turkey will be divided. So this phobia, they had it in the last 40 years.
Mm.
Before, this wasn't like that. They really respected Kurds before, because they were Kurds were living in an autonomy status before Turkey became a nation state. And but the way people have been educated in school, the way they have given the image of Kurds, they have given the image of the Kurdish area, Kurdistan, which is a word Ottoman Empire created themselves. Kurdistan, which means the land where Kurds are living. So the history books has been manipulated, and it is still like that. What they are trying to do is to educate people in Ottoman language as mother tongue language, which people are getting forced. So what I said in the beginning, because of the military constitution from which is the constitution from 1982. Is preventing a lot of the developments in the area. So it is based on Turkification politics, and this is creating problem for making developments in Turkey, where they can discuss about the democratic process in the area. And it has also created problems for the economic people. The justice minister admitted himself that they have used each week $100 million against PKK. So they has in 30 years there has been $400 billion against PKK. So this has also prevented the many businessmen to make investments in north part of Kurdistan, which is eastern Turkey. So. It has been a very big problem to make some reforms in that area, economical reforms in that area. And what's the model they are trying to create in Rojava is a cooperative model. They have tried to do that similar in the north part, but what happened, a lot of civil societies who were supporting this kind of model was that they have been arrested. So there's 10,000 political prisoners in Turkish prison now. So these are not only Kurds. They are academic people, lawyers, journalists, many people who are supporting the democratic model of autonomy are in jail. And the last meeting from National Security Council, they made a decision that people will be more arrested. Those who are in the threat of the Turkey's eye, they will be arrested. And then now there has been a mass arrest, especially of young people in Turkey. There has been mass arrest of some also people in trade unions.
Where?
In Turkey.
All over.
Yeah, yeah. Take people from the fact that it's their weapons. Because a lot of the weapons which has been given to coalition to fight against Assad is in the hands of the ISIS now. Because ISIS melted them, they made a domination over them, and they took the weapon of them. So when YPG asks for... When YPG is asking for weapon support, not to protect themselves, they are asking for support to protect the civilians, because they are ready to die. For the people there.
So you know, your identity, your affiliation, and everything, so to it can be used against you. So most of the Kurdish people do not want to be inside these camps. What happens is that there are, in the municipalities, like Kurdish cities were run by the Kurdish party, they are kind of like having camps, their own camps, or their own, like, trying to make their own facilities for this amount of people. But the thing is, Turkey, the governance of Turkey is not giving enough funding to the local governance to support the refugee problem. So basically right now, and I have to say the winter is really tough in there. So right now there's a really urgent situation of shelter, clothes, as health care as well. So I mean, maybe one of the things that here can, you know, support is, it can be that, like, refugee problem is a huge problem, which will also affect other countries, because Turkey is also a watchdog of European Union when it comes to refugees, because so there will be a flow of refugees as well, which will be a problem of British government as well.